Good evening. I'm Dr. Kristen Koenig. I'm Professor of Sociology here at Concordia, and it's an absolute pleasure to introduce you this evening to Dr. David Meyer. Dr. Meyer is a Professor of Sociology, Political Science and Planning, Policy and Design at the University of California Irvine, and he has written extensively on social movements, considering the episodic nature of social movements as well as their effectiveness. These themes are explored in his newest book, which is How Social Movements Sometimes Matter. I've had the pleasure of assigning another one of Dr. Meyer's books, The Politics of Protest, in my social movements course and have been inspired by his description of how social movements have been woven into the American experience. Tonight, as part of the Enduring Questions and Ideas Core Convocation Series, Dr. Meyer will consider the role of social movements in today's politics. Please put your hands together and welcome Dr. David Meyer.
Thank you. I'm so pleased to be here. It's so exciting to come back to Concordia. The last time I was in this room, I had a daughter playing flute sitting right around there. And I just hope I can give you a smidgen of the delight that I got from watching her. I was delighted to accept the invitation to come here. I came up with the title Social Movements and Democracy in Today's Politics, and that was before COVID. So I had to revise the lecture a couple of times because today kept moving forward. So that was about 6 or 8 years ago when this date was scheduled. And when I was thinking about today, the deal I made with myself when I went to graduate school is that I would always try to relate what I was studying to contemporary events. That has been disturbingly easy in the field that I've taken on. And I'm going to start with the Freedom Convoy. The Freedom Convoy is operating in Canada now, and there's a lot we can learn from it even at this point. One, a small committed group has been able to command national attention. And this is a social movement lesson. By running a blockade, by staging a sit-in, a drive-in in Ottawa, they've disrupted public order, they've disrupted commerce. And over the last couple of days, we've had arrests and police blockades. All of this draws tremendous attention to the drivers, a very small group, and maybe a little bit less to their cause. But it's a perfect case for looking at social movements and how they're supposed to work. Social protest causes disruption to demand attention to a cause, a constituency, and it sets an agenda for action. It demands attention from the rest of society and from political figures. Controversy is part of the deal. Criticism is part of the deal. You go in knowing all that is coming. And success, at least proximate success, is about getting attention to your cause. If they're paying some attention to the cause in addition to the tactics, you're making a difference. So what do the drivers care about? Vaccines and mandates. That's what they started with. There is a policy that drivers had to be fully vaccinated in order to cross the border down to the United States. But once there's a spotlight on a movement, other causes creep in. And when those other causes creep in, it causes difficulty for a movement and maybe for society. So you know about Canada. In Canada, they've got like maple syrup and bacon and hockey and stuff. And the drivers command attention by slowing international commerce, and oh, suddenly there's a Confederate flag. And suddenly there's a Nazi swastika. Now, I don't know that the drivers were after that, but once they got attention, other people see the spotlight and climb in. That's an interesting case because the drivers are going uphill. God, I didn't think of that beforehand. That probably works. Yes, the drivers are going uphill. 90% of the drivers in Canada are already fully vaccinated. 70% of Canadians support vaccine mandates. 93% of Canadians support efforts to remove the protesters in Ottawa. 68% support police action to take the drivers out and restore international commerce. So, drivers successful? They certainly are successful in getting attention. Not so successful in changing opinion or converting allies, at least north of the border. And on the one hand, I started thinking, well, that's kind of the way democracy should work, right? So you make your cause, you make your case, and if you lose in the public sphere, you lose. That's fair. And then I started thinking, you know who that is, right? That's at the March on Washington in 1963. At the time of the march, 25% of Americans supported a mass demonstration on the National Mall. That is a distinct minority. And it makes the issues more complicated. A reminder, protest is a tool of those who are losing or who's scared of losing. And protest movements are comprised of people who are, let's call them stalwarts, let's call them saints, let's call them psychopaths. It's all of these people, people who are going to protest regardless of what the circumstances are. Their commitment is so strong. And I like to pull out Jeanette Rankin here. Maybe some of you have learned about her in your unit on the suffragettes. Jeanette Rankin was elected to Congress twice, about 20 years apart. She's the first woman ever elected to the U.S. Congress, a Republican from Montana. Of course, in those days, Montana was different, and so was the Republican Party. Jeanette Rankin voted against U.S. entry into World War I and was immediately turned out of office. She was the only one to vote against U.S. entry into World War I. 20 years later, she ran for that seat again and was elected and was the person who voted against U.S. entry into World War II and again was turned out of office the next time she came up. So two-year terms, 20 years apart. Jeanette Rankin is a great story, but is less interesting to me than the Jeanette Rankin Brigade. When do larger numbers of people protest in concert? When do you get large social movements, not just the stalwarts? I'm going to give you some background that you probably already know. Okay. Organizations grow by unifying broad, diverse coalitions that create political problems and opportunities. Conflict helps. Okay. Organizers always try to mobilize people. Any cause you can imagine, there's somebody trying to recruit followers right now. But most people get involved only when a cause is particularly threatening or promising. And the example that I've always stuck with is in large cities, you see men selling umbrellas on street corners, and some of them are aggressive. They go out and they price really well. Some of them are kind of passive. Some of them twirl. But the thing that makes the biggest difference in how much they sell is whether it's raining or not. Organizers do the best when it's raining. Movements are diverse collections of activities. They're events, they're organizations, ideas, and individuals. And when you study movements, the really cool thing about studying movements is you can focus on any one of these things. There is a range of actions, institutional and extra-institutional, and there are blurry boundaries between who's in and outside of a movement. So we can think about Occupy as a social movement, with institutional representatives that are contemporaneous, like Bernie Sanders, and that follow on, like Elizabeth Warren and Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. And in a kind of way, our Congresswoman, Katie Porter. Social movements work by posing a problem, making other people pay attention to their problem. Social movements are really good when they're successful at posing the problem, at generating attention. They're usually really bad at offering solutions. They usually push toward overly simplistic solutions because they're not policymakers, because they hold broad coalitions together, because everybody doesn't agree on what to do. So honk for peace. Okay. Institutional responses. Social movements force the public, then leaders, to pay attention and respond. The power they get comes from the size and scope of activity. The puzzle is managing growth and control. You guys have grown up in an extraordinarily contested period with vigorous social movements across the political spectrum. You've seen, but may not remember, the Tea Party in 2009. The Tea Party was organized around stopping the Affordable Care Act, and they failed and transformed politics. The Tea Party flourished after Barack Obama was elected president. And think about this. This makes sense. When you have easier ways to try to get what you want, when you can get invited inside the White House, you're less likely to protest outdoors. In 2010, the Tea Party kind of dissipated, partly because Republicans won massive gains in the midterm elections. In 2011, after those gains, Occupy took off after Republican victories. Movements are built into the design of American political institutions. I'm one of these geektrons who thinks that everybody should read Federalist 10, because Federalist 10 is the Rosetta Stone of American politics. In it, James Madison, yeah, I put a picture of the Boston Tea Party, is because we have this illusion that America would endorse protest because we're born of protest. Madison says, we want to allow people to organize. We want to encourage people to organize, because taking away liberty is worse than anything else. But, we have to make sure they don't influence policy too much. So what do? We encourage people to organize. We allow movements, we allow groups, but we have a large country with lots of interests and make it impossible for anybody to win. Federalism, checks and balances. Movements end up filtered, fragmented, and frustrated. And you can add some other F words if you want. Implications for activists, multiple targets. You're upset about COVID. You're upset about masks. Do you go to your local school board? Do you vote for a congressional representative? Do you march on Washington, Sacramento? Targets everywhere. Frequent elections. So there's always something you should be doing. And on the policy front, many, 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 many veto points. Because change, it makes change slow. Okay, now we're going to come up to where I started the talk, writing the talk 4 years ago when I was invited here. The Trump era and political protest, what you've seen. So walking around Irvine, I would meet people, and they would say, Donald Trump, must be great for you studying protest. And here's my little nod to English literature. It was the worst of times. Because although there was plenty of protest, I explained, I got to live here too. Okay? Tons of protest immediately. The Women's March, that should say 2017, I apologize. The biggest demonstration in American history, 3 to 4 million people. In Los Angeles, it was about 750,000, in DC, about 500,000. Big show. United against Trump, much bigger than the inaugural crowd, and Trump didn't resign. Did that mean it didn't work? How do you tell if it worked? Well, you say, let's go back and see what they wanted. What a mess. Because there were 650 sponsoring groups for the first Women's March. 650. Here's the front first page of the things they wanted. Women's rights are human rights, end violence, reproductive rights, LGBTQIA, workers' rights, disability rights, immigrant rights, environmental justice. Good at posing problems, tough at coming up with solutions. So, okay, it was the best of times. There were colorful, innovative protests, like the airport protests, in response to the Muslim ban 1 week after the Women's March. But that's just the beginning. After a shooting in Parkland, Florida, you had the student movement that led to March for Our Lives. You recognize them, right? Successful mobilization polarizes. It pushes people to take sides. It stiffens the spines of your allies, weakens the resolve of your opponents, and encourages others to take action. And in this regard, the women's movement was extraordinarily successful because every weekend in Washington, D.C., there was another cause. There was a day without immigrants, a day without women. There was a march for science, a march for truth, a march for tax justice, a people's climate march, a march for science. And I'm sure I'm leaving out 30. None of that was fresh or new. All of it came from groups that existed beforehand, suddenly able to attract larger audiences, suddenly able to bring more people out because of the nature of the opponent they focused on. That was Trump. Okay, these are the kinds of movements that were existing beforehand. There were also social movements on the right that were mobilized for a completely different reason. Normally on the margins of mainstream America, white nationalists were invited into mobilization. This was a moment when they were acceptable in broad politics in a way that they had not seen in recent years. You saw the turnout in Charlottesville, a Unite the Right march, which included Nazis and nationalists of all sorts. And encouraged when President Trump responded with the infamous comment, "I think there are good people on all sides there." Ooh. Okay. Authorities respond to protest. They try to reduce the force and divisiveness of protest movements and diffuse the focus. And they have a bunch of tools. They can repress and arrest to marginalize. They can use rhetoric to endorse goals and welcome people in and talk to them. They can set up commissions to study the problem. They can consult and engage. You know, have you seen for the last 5-6 months, there are people protesting against Joe Manchin all the time, right? You've seen that. And they catch him on the way to his boat. And Manchin is a very accomplished politician. He always responds by like giving out a card or a phone number, says, "Come into the office, we'll talk." And he meets with all of them and listens to them and is sympathetic and changes nothing. That's what a skilled politician does. Okay. Social movements also make politicians respond to their questions. Because of the protest movements, reporters ask politicians the same questions and they have to answer again and again and again and again. And skillful politicians on both sides of the aisle respond by being sympathetic. They say, "I'm sure these people are well motivated, but we have to consider this. Trump was less disciplined." All of the answers came with attacks. He attacked the protesters as un-American, communists. He attacked the judges who ruled against him. He changed his goals. He softened his policies and toughened his rhetoric, making things even harsher. This is the context that takes us up to 2020. In 2020, Trump is in office, COVID strikes, governors respond in all kinds of ways, and citizens respond by challenging restrictions on social life. Look at the Open Up protest in Lansing, Michigan. Governor Whitmer had perhaps the most restrictive of all the states. You could go out on a rowboat, but not a powerboat for a while. And the protesters showed up in Lansing, armed. And I look at that picture, and I'm reminded that Ronald Reagan, as governor of California, signed gun control legislation after Black Panthers marched on the Capitol in Sacramento. And the Panthers were carrying long rifles. And there's nothing like Black men in berets carrying rifles to change a politician's opinion about gun control. I wonder if Michigan white men in camo carrying semi-automatic weapons will have a similar reaction. Not only did we have the reopen protests, we also had the resurrection of Black Lives Matter. Black Lives Matter started as a hashtag in 2013 after Trayvon Martin was killed. It is a slogan, it is an organization, and it's a movement. And it resurrected after George Floyd was murdered. Starting in Minneapolis, and then every one of those little dots was the site of Black Lives Matter protests, changing public discourse. Savvy politicians respond to protest in the streets. Savvy politicians adjust and try to take advantage of the energy in the street, because people who go out to protest are the people who are likely to work in your campaign if you can recruit them. They're the people who are going to go out to vote. Sometimes they're even the people who give money. In the Democratic primaries, there was a harsh focus on Trump. Joe Biden, by disposition and experience a conciliator, moved to the center of the Democratic Party, which was far to the left of where he'd ever been before. Biden is elected, and it changes the opportunities that people face. Okay, I'm putting the numbers up there, and you have to understand that in any democratic system, this would have been a substantial victory, almost 7 million votes. And it changes the calculus for all involved. Biden comes into office with one advantage. He's not Donald Trump. And with many disadvantages. He comes into office with the impossible task of satisfying the social movements that put him there. Among the allies who challenge him, I can't even read. I've got immigrant rights, I've got climate change, and what's the upper left-hand corner? Student debt. That's kind of irrelevant here, right? Right, remember? And the student debt people look at Joe Biden, they say, You promised you would do something about it. And he says, I'm working on it. And the immigrant rights people say, but you promised you would fix immigration. And he says, I'm working on it. And the climate change people say, you promised you would address climate change. And he says, look, I've got car chargers and public transportation and research from batteries all and Build Back Better. When that passes, you'll see. And they say, it's not enough. And by the way, when did that pass? And you know the answer to that. He can't satisfy his allies. And his opponents are worse. Okay? This is an extraordinary moment that we're living through when armed protesters seize the Capitol, even for just a few hours, saying that the election is illegitimate. One of the portraits behind the man with the Confederate flag is Charles Sumner, who was caned on the floor of the House of Representatives for his abolitionist positions. Another congressman beat him. It's something to remember. Now, there's stuff to think about here. There's a lot about the protest at the Capitol that wasn't new. The idea that we lost at the polls, let's take to the streets, sure, that happens all the time. After Trump took office, Disrupt J20 turned out in Washington, D.C., broke windows, vandalized a limousine, over 200 arrests. Not new. The scale was a little bit more impressive. Okay. The organizations were not new. The Proud Boys have been around for 5-7 years, okay, promoting Western values, whatever that means, which was translated into a fetish for direct action and white nationalism. The Oath Keepers, a group that's a little bit older, which has similar commitments. Their leader is charged with conspiracy for leading an organized group up through the Capitol. He says, and I got this from today's newspaper, he says, we only entered the Capitol after Ashley Babbitt was shot. There's a timeline which shows, no, that's not quite right. Okay. In addition to the protest in Washington, D.C., there's grassroots action across the United States. In school districts across the United States, you see people protesting against masks, against vaccines. That's how social movements work. What is very different this time is the President of the United States urged the crowd to attack his enemies, to intimidate his allies, to keep them as allies, with absolutely no deference to the Constitution. And the striking thing is, you look at those guys, no, not those guys, Biden, Clinton, George W. Bush, George H.W. Bush, Obama, all of them tried with minimal success to represent all Americans, to reach out to all Americans. They weren't very good at doing it, but they tried. Trump made no pretense of trying that. And so now we have the prosecution of over 700 people. The first sentences are plea bargains. Jenna Ryan, who's in the middle shot there, is a real estate agent from Texas. At first she said, look, I'm a white girl. There's no way they're going to send me to prison, which was a mistake to say before that she negotiated a plea bargain, because the prosecutor insisted that she is going to prison. And she said, well, it's good. I'll eat healthy and lose some weight, which is not the way most of us think about prison. And you've seen the QAnon shaman, because he's a striking figure in all the pictures, sentenced to 41 months. He said, in his defense, I've struggled with mental illness. His lawyer said after the sentence, he's got a lot to be angry about. He should be angry at Donald Trump. Trump hints at pardoning them if he was returned to office. This is a dramatic change in the way presidents have approached protest. So this takes us full circle back to Canada. Back to Canada. In the last 2 days, the Prime Minister of Canada has declared a state of emergency, which is endorsed across the political spectrum by conservatives and the Liberal Party. The state of emergency allows arrests, allows the deployment of the military, and allows them to seize the trucks. Okay. Prosecutions will follow. As long as the Freedom Convoy can't get allies in mainstream politics, its influence can be curtailed. And that is the striking difference between the United States right now and Canada. Because although the Freedom Convoy has had a hard time getting support in Canada, American politicians on the right, including Trump, including Rand Paul, have said, we need more of that. That's great. I hope, Rand Paul said, they can get through the border and disrupt the Super Bowl, which seems like a crazy thing for a politician to say. So we are at an open moment. Institutional responses will matter, reforms, recriminations, blame, prosecutions. But white nationalism is not going to disappear, nor are the critics of Biden on the left who are going to continue to demand he deliver on some of those promises. So how do you live your life? That was the question I was given, but I didn't get it until tonight. So here's what I've been able to think of so far. Protest is good, but you want to build institutions and respect for those institutions. You want to have respect for expertise. And your tactics must reflect some element of humility. And I've kind of come full circle, realizing that the ideal of nonviolence is based in a kind of humility. This is what I believe, but I may be wrong. And it's harder to take the stance that I'm willing to suffer for my beliefs than I'm willing to hurt for my beliefs. And that's the litmus test I'm coming to. And I'm ending in a difficult place because I don't know the answer, but I know that you're going to create the answer. Do the white nationalist forces maintain? Does their focus stay the same? How do progressive activists continue when they have constrained allies in mainstream politics? I don't know the answers to any of this, but I do know that we make the history that will follow. Thank you very much.